start.
Yes, I do. It works like a...
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments, to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon, deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
His people sing hallelujah.
God, the Holy One, you are the Lord Most High, who in the Spirit praises God in Father's glory night.
Blessed Lord, raised all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Help us so to hear them, to read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that through patience and the comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and forever hold fast the hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Saviour, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth. For I am God, and there is no other. By myself I have sworn, from my mouth has gone forth in righteousness a word that shall not return. To me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. Only in the Lord, it shall be said of me, are righteousness and strength. All who were incensed against him shall come to him and be ashamed. In the Lord, all the offspring of Israel shall triumph and glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
An extract from Psalm 119, and the response shall be, when your word goes forth, it gives light. When your word goes forth, it gives light. Your decrees are wonderful, therefore I obey them with all my heart. When your word goes forth, it gives light. It gives understanding to the simple.
When your word goes forth, It gives light.
I open my mouth and pant. I long for your commandments. Turn me in mercy, as you always do, to those who love your name.
When your word goes forth, it gives light.
Steady my footsteps in your word. Let no iniquity have dominion over me. Rescue me from those who oppress me, and I will keep your commandments.
When your word goes forth, it gives light.
Let your countenance shine upon your servant, and teach me to your statutes, and teach me your statutes. My eyes shed streams of tears because people do not keep your law.
When your word goes forth, it gives light.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. We who are strong ought to put up with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us must please our neighbour for the good purpose of building up the neighbour. For Christ did not please himself, but, as it is written, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the scriptures we might have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went back to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself,' and you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things which we have heard you did at Capernaum.'" And he said, "Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and Holy Spirit the Comforter. Amen. I guess we've all experienced the discomfort of disagreements. You know what I mean. You get home. You push the door open. Shout, "Hi!" And then realise that two of the family are in the middle of a row. It's uncomfortable, to say the least. Nobody enjoys the tetchy atmosphere caused by clashing opinions. So the first thing you need to do is to try to work out exactly what's going on. Hence today's letter, written by Paul, to the church in Rome, to inspire, to teach and to encourage their Christian faith. It's rich in theology and has been scrutinized by generations of Christians over the decades. Around AD 54, maybe 58, Paul writes this letter to a young church, in fact, one he hadn't even yet visited. And it's comprised of a potent mixture of Jews and Gentiles. This is indeed fertile ground for differing opinions in matters of Christian doctrine. For example, when they're contemplating what is allowable and what is frowned upon for Christian behaviour. So here, in this letter, we are plunging ourselves into the middle of a heated dispute about one aspect of Christian living. Why are some happy to eat meat and others are not? We discern that Paul is seeking to reconcile these two groups who have very differing opinions and views about food and wine. Sounds strangely familiar? Perhaps. We have our own discussions, don't we? About eating meat, vegetarianism, perhaps even becoming vegan. And perhaps a complete different, separate discussion about consuming alcohol and in what amounts and so on. So whilst our modern discussions are concerned with things like animal welfare, dietary health, and losing self-control, the debates we hear about in the Romans letter have a different origin. They're rooted in religious and cultural practices. And it's down to their approach to freedom. The weak, as Paul puts it, which is those Jews or converts who attempt to obey the law as closely as possible, are compared to the strong, who believe they are free, set free from such rules and regulations by Christ's salvation. In a way, this echoes the manner in which some Christians today often use Bible quotes. They pick out the bits that suit them. Today is Bible Sunday. I didn't know whether you know that. It probably tells you on the top of your sheet if you bother to read it. The Bible is rightly revered as a special and unique book. Yet many Christians fall out over the interpretation of particular passages, such as those on marriage and divorce, or sexual orientation, and the like. Even though we Christians generally get on well with other denominations, it tends to be true that we may have deep-seated reservations about one or two biblical interpretations that our neighbours have. Not surprising, we're all different, aren't we? But it can lead to open hostility, even vengeful violence has been seen as a marked trait between some Christians, say, for example, in the past in Northern Ireland. You've seen it there. Paul encourages the church members to act in a way that benefits others rather than being self-centered. So, what does Paul do to help them here? He instructs them to act not to indulge their own preferences, but to please our neighbours for their good, to build them up, to be unselfish about your attitudes. Now that's a good point. Think about the health and growth and development of others first. After all, being told another rule or instruction or regulation won't change them, and it probably won't change us either. The law really has no power to save us. It just tells us where we fall short. Trusting in Jesus does save us. Now, Paul's concern is that the church remains united and focused on the most utmost importance, the issue that's really important to the early church and still to us today. It's the sharing of the gospel. In the midst of arguments, it's really easy to congregate in rival camps, have a niggle at each other, and not work through the issue to maintain healthy relationships. So the focus is indeed on relationships, our relationships with each other, our relationships with those who don't yet know the good news of Jesus, and our own relationship with God. That is where the Bible comes in. In order to nurture our own relationship with God, we need, as today's collect prayer puts it, to read, mark, inwardly digest the scriptures. Actually, I missed out the word learn. Perhaps we should do that one as well. I'll read it again. To read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest the scriptures. That will develop our relationship with God, and our love of Jesus, and our trust in the Holy Spirit's guidance. Oh dear. This seems a far cry from the political wranglings of our nation currently, doesn't it? Seeing each other's point of view and the like. And even further removed from the appalling warfare being waged in places like Ukraine and Russia, and elsewhere, of course. Yet Jesus knew what it was like to be a child refugee and an asylum seeker and to live in an occupied land and to be wrongly accused and to be tortured and ultimately killed for our sake. Yet Jesus did not duck the issues of his day. In fact, did you hear that in the gospel? When invited to read the scriptures in his own hometown, Nazareth, he took the opportunity to announce his own agenda using the words of the prophet Isaiah. It's a very well-known passage, but just look at the potency of it. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. His hearers were astonished at Jesus' eloquence, yet he realized that they were also somewhat skeptical towards him. How could this carpenter's son be speaking such words of compassion and wisdom? How could this lad that we've known as a toddler now be claiming to speak for God, promoting himself in the words of the great prophet Isaiah? Clearly, Jesus' fame had spread to his own hometown, as had the reports of his miracles and his healings. He confronts them. No, he challenges them by indicating that their prejudices against this homegrown prophet made it hard for him to be heard, saying, "No prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown." That's not such a strange idea. Think about it. It's often easier to open up about our own faith to total strangers or people who don't know us well. Probably easier than talking to friends and family about our faith. People who know us well have already formed an opinion about us, and we've probably formed an opinion about them as well. And that can sometimes get in the way of genuine conversation. Jesus said he had been anointed to bring God's good news of freedom and love. He carried through his promise by submitting ultimately to humiliation and death. As baptized Christians, we are unlikely to be called upon to surrender our lives so very fully. But we are still anointed as Christ's ambassadors to the people of our time and place in history, here, now, in Keyworth, and in the Benefice. So how can we open up about our faith? The answer is, wherever there are opportunities to make relationships, anytime you meet somebody, even if you don't know them, there is an opportunity. With people who do not know you at all, it's a chance to actually mention about your faith. Throw it into the conversation if you can. You never know, you might just spark an interest. You have an opportunity, perhaps, for example, be it volunteering at the new Warm Spaces initiative starting in the Priorcal Hall on Friday in December, or popping in when you donate to the food bank, or turning up to support Magdalene's Cafe. All these are places where you encounter people that you may not encounter any other way. Perhaps you could offer to bring along a child, maybe one of your friend's children, obviously, not just out of the blue, to the Storytime Initiative on Tuesdays after school. Often such actions speak louder than words. I'm sure you can think of other ways to serve the needs of your unknown neighbours in Christ, and an opportunity to mention your faith. However you respond, please do ask God's Spirit to guide you in your choice. I conclude with the prayer that Paul offered at the end of today's reading. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another, in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together we may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty Father, we thank you for your love, that you sent your Son to teach us to live and to die for us and for all humanity. We pray that your whole church on earth may be renewed by your Spirit, to live more truly in your way and more effectively spread your kingdom. We pray for Stephen, our Archbishop, Paul and Andy, our bishops, all the clergy, lay readers and other lay leaders in this diocese, and especially for Father Tom, our rector. We pray for churches together in Keyworth, and we ask that you will enable us to acknowledge and resolve our differences and be able to spread your word more effectively in this place. Deepen our faith, fill us with hope, enable us to reach out across generations and cultures to proclaim your love and forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, we long to see your kingdom come on earth. But looking around, we see confusion, fear, conflict, hunger, climate change. Enable the political leaders of the world to look beyond their differences and to work for the common good of humanity. Enable them to reach out and make peace. Especially we pray for Charles, our King, and for the government of this country. We ask that you will give our politicians a clear vision that is good for all of our citizens. We pray for those who teach, who work in the health service, in local government, in the emergency services, that they may feel valued and that they may be enabled to meet the needs that they see in individuals and in society. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, we thank you for the rich community life here in Keyworth, for voluntary organisations that enrich the lives of so many, for sports clubs, for uniformed organisations, for charitable groups, for the food bank, Keyworth Abundance, U3A, Community Research Concern. We pray that you will continue to raise up gifted leaders to carry on this work. We pray for ourselves as we try to reach out and work alongside you in the community. We ask for wisdom as we set up a warm space for the winter in Keyworth. We ask that it may help people
understand your love for them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As we pray for our community, we particularly think of those who live or work on Highview Avenue, Meadow Drive, and the Ridings, especially any known to us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We ask that you will be alongside those who are ill or suffering at the moment, that you will give strength and love to those who care for them and for their family and friends. We think especially of those who are in our thoughts just now. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your keeping those who have died recently, especially Colin Stallworthy and Jeff Hollington. We ask you to be with the grieving friends and relatives. We lift before you those whose year's mind falls this week: Ethel Marshall, Ian James Hewitt, Sybil Evelyn Boots, Sally Mae Jameson, and others we have loved and see no more. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty Father, we give you thanks, and we pray that you will accept these prayers in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. We stand to declare our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We are the body of Christ. In one spirit, we are all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace. and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Now the hymn 198. 198. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, it is our duty and our joy, at all times and in all places, to give you thanks and praise. Holy Father, Heavenly King, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, for he is your living word. Through him you have created all things from the beginning, and formed us in your own image. Through him you freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him born of a woman to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you sent upon us your holy and life-giving spirit and made us a people for your own possession. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you, and say, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. He who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. Gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Body and blood of Christ.
body and blood of Christ. The body and blood of Christ. The body and blood of Christ. Body and blood of Christ. The body and blood of Christ. The body and blood of Christ. Let us pray. God of all grace, your Son, Jesus Christ, fed the hungry with the bread of life and the word of his kingdom. Renew your people with your heavenly grace. In all our weakness, sustain us by your true and living bread, who is alive and reigns, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and mind in knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Our final hymn will be number 277. 277.
Success.